Dobro jutro to the representatives of the country of my wife. Good morning. And today I'd like to talk about the influence of the adjunctive classical homeopathy on global health status and subjective well-being in cancer patients. This is a pragmatic, randomized, controlled trial. Now, my background is academic study from 1972 to 1978, and I started homeopathy in 1976 when I met my teacher, Professor Gerhard Resch. Some of you might have already met him or have read his book from 1986 together with Professor Goodman, Scientific Contribution or the Foundations of Homeopathy. Then I trained at the Medical University of Vienna in starting 1978, and I have my private homeopathic practice since 1990. Then, due to my interest in airway management, I started with intensive care medicine in 1985 up to 2004. During this time, I was undercover applying homeopathy to patients at the ICU, and some of the nurses recognized that I'm doing something strange sometime. But you know, I don't believe in zodiacs, but I'm a fish, and so for fish it's very easy to swim around and not to talk too much. In 2004, my current head of the Department of Internal Medicine I, Professor Zielinski, had the idea to start an outpatient unit, homeopathy in malignant diseases at the Medical University of Vienna. And since this time, I'm doing this up to September 2019. And those of you who would like to work in Vienna, you could continue then. Now, this is the General Hospital of Vienna. I'm working at the Red Tower. So if you would like to visit, I would encourage you. Now, what I'm most interested in is a constructive dialogue between conventional and homeopathic medicine, because, you know, I like Middle Ages, I like Malta, I like all these things, but I don't like this continuous fighting about nothing, because I think there is so much possibilities, so many possibilities in this world. I am sure you could combine homeopathy together with conventional medicine. And I still continue to insert central jugular catheters into bone marrow transplant patients, and I like to treat patients with heart cardiac arrest. So, but on the other side, then I like to give some globals. Now, the scope of application of homeopathy in oncology, in my eyes, there are several topics. There's the elevation of side effects, which is most interesting for patients suffering from side effects in chemotherapy or radiation therapy and or surgical therapy. Then I think it's helpful to solve blockades, and patients suffering from cancer also sometimes suffer from secondary diseases, and it is helpful to support them in this respect. Then female patients suffering from amenorrhea sometimes might be helped because the menstruation might be restored again. And the last two points, I think, are the most important. I would like to strengthen the constitution and enhance life quality. Now, 2 years ago, we have published this paper together with several colleagues, also from the Department of Oncology and from Pharmacy, and Katharina Gärtner, she's also with us here, and the gentleman from Statistics, and also my brother from Tel Aviv, Menachem Oberbaum, who could be a sibling. Now, the outpatient unit at the Medical University of Vienna is at this division of oncology, and patients are treated conventionally by help of chemotherapy, radiation, and or surgery. Optional So patients might also ask for add-on homeopathy, and there are about 600 patients contacts per year in this outpatient unit. It's a one-man show, so not too many patients. The aim of this study was whether additive homeopathy might influence the global health status and the reproductive well-being of cancer patients as an adjunct to conventional cancer therapy. And I have met these patients every 9 weeks. So I think this is possible also in a social health system. The study was approved by the ethical committee of the Medical University of Vienna, and inclusion criteria were patients with an age of more than 18 years prior to the first conventional treatment. Exclusion criteria included inability to comply with the study protocol and mental inability to fill out the questionnaires. Now, the methods, of course, included an elaborate medical history with questions also relating to social and private circumstances, and the symptoms given by the patients were now correlated with the signs of homeopathic evaluation of remedies as recorded in repertoires. As you can see from my age, I'm still using the things which we have been used before, as they're called books. But now my young colleagues are, of course, more prone to electronic devices, and of course I also use them, but for some reason I'm not sure what is really better. There might be an intense discussion about this. Now, this slide includes the statistic information and accounting for an expected dropout rate of about 25%. A study with 2 times 191 patients would give an 80% power based on a two-sided significance level of 5%. And the use of a multiple imputation method with 50 simulation runs and constraints between 0 and 100 to impute missing values for the second and third visit was used. This means not every question was responded or answered, or a patient was coming for the first and the second time, but he did not show up for the third time for several reasons. So you have to impute those missing values, and there's a special statistic method, which is also called the carried-on of values. It was a pragmatic, randomized control trial, and 410 patients with a standard anti-cancer therapy were included. Patients were randomized to receive or not to receive additive homeopathic therapy in addition to the standard therapy. And the setting was at the Medical University of Vienna, at the Department of Medicine I, Clinical Division of Oncology. Now, what's the difference to other studies? If you look to the study of Rostock, for example, he has compared patients from two different centers. Now, this is, to my knowledge, the first study which compares patients from the same institution. It was prospective, controlled, randomized using a computer-generated code. 200 patients received conventional treatment, while 210 patients received additionally individually selected homeopathic remedies. It was an open pragmatic trial, and there was no placebo in the control group. Now, you can discuss whether or not it would have been fine to have placebo in the second group, but I think it doesn't make sense, because I believe that the possible suggestive role of the physician together with the placebo could be combined to one group, mostly influenced by the Swiss group of Spinetti and Wurster. We used Q potencies with increasing potencies starting. This is the difference to Switzerland with a Q1. In addition, also C and LM potencies were used. And homeopathic remedies, and I think this is very important that we are aware of the pharmaceutical quality of the globules. The homeopathic remedies were prepared according to the European Pharmacopoeia and Homeopathic Pharmacopoeia, and we are prepared at the Maria Troy Pharmacy in Vienna, Austria. So skew potencies are Quinquat, Ginter, millesimal potencies, and there's a quantitative application of 2.5 milliliter dilution onto 50,000 globules. The first reiteration is until CH3, and then there is a continued a repetitive dilution and succussion performed. And it was Hahnemann's last discovery in Paris, which hasn't been published for about 80 years, until Dr. Hale in Germany could get the last copy of his sixth edition of the Organon. And what most of us might have experienced, that those potencies have a very mild influence on the patients. And we have also the feeling that there's a quicker action by frequent repetition of the remedy with no side effects to the patients. So I'm almost not aware of a patient who's saying, now I had a severe problem, which I feel is due to the dew potencies. A few patients say, I have a small side effect, and some of them say, I have a special taste, but usually only during the first few applications. Now, Ilse Muhic, who is with us here at this conference, she is a very active and meticulous pharmacist, and she prepares these potencies, which were then given to those patients for free. Our analysis comprises 373 patients, and there's a comparison between the first and third visit, and we used the EORTC QLQ C30 form version 3 for quality of life. In addition, especially developed small form evaluating subjective well-being using a visual analog scale. Now, if you look here, there was no difference with regard to age, and as in most studies and also in most practices, there are 2/3 of women. Why are there always more women than men using complementary therapies? Now, my homeopathic teacher, Dr. Resch, he says this is because females are born with a common sense, while men first try to use the brain until the brain is activated. So sometimes, some years, maybe some decades, until they understand, except those of my of those males who are present here, of course. And most patients were suffering from breast cancer and hematological cancers or diseases, gastrointestinal cancer, lung cancer, and also the metastatic disease, chemotherapy, radiation frequency was comparable. Now, altogether, there were 453 patients. Some have declined before randomizations, before consenting to participate. So they were randomized 410 patients, some of them allocated to intervention, and some declined to participate, as also in the control group. So at the end, there were 194 patients answering the questions at the first visit, and 179 at the first visit for the controls. Now, this is a small slide, but I'm sorry, we have so many results, so we are very proud of it. And if you look here, subjective well-being and global health status was improved in the homeopathic group between the first and the third visit. Also, all functioning parameters were improved in the homeopathic group. In addition, also fatigue. Furthermore, pain and dyspnea have improved, and the only one was diarrhea, which was deteriorated. In the control group, the subjective well-being was also improving, and also the role function parameter. However, in nausea, vomiting, as well as pain, and also with diarrhea and constipation, as well as appetite loss, there was a deterioration. Now, if we compare homeopathy, and this I think is the most important information, if you compare homeopathy versus control, there's a significant improvement of global health status as well as subjective well-being in the homeopathic group versus the control group. Furthermore, in all control, in all functioning parameters, as well as fatigue and also pain, dyspnea, insomnia, and also appetite loss. So I think this is the most important information that subjective well-being, global health status, function parameters, and also many side effects were decreased in when compared to controls. This is just showing the use of other alternatives and multiple answers were possible. And so this is a list of the most used remedies during its Q potencies in those patients. Now, I think this is the first positive control study evaluating add-on classical homeopathy in cancer patients at the same center. And as reported, the global health status as well as subjective well-being improved significantly with homeopathy. Okay, I would just show you two samples, very simple samples. 68, male patient, he underwent surgery because of cholangiocarcinoma, and there was a partial liver resection. He also received a chemotherapy with gemcitabine/oxaliplatin, and the side effects were nausea, loss of appetite. 1 year ago, he underwent surgery because of a rectum carcinoma. He was retired. He was perspiring on the head. He had his eyes X-ray was from a flabby appearance, headstrong, and I gave him strychnosnox vomica, calcium sulfuricum. There was an increasing flatulence in the lower part of the abdomen, nausea, loss of appetite. I still believe in Nash. He thinks flatulence in the lower part of the abdomen might fit to Lycopodium. Then the patient reported that he has less side effects with respect to nausea and appetite. The lung was unchanged, and chemotherapy continued. So I continued with higher potencies of Lycopodium. And then something happened which I like very much, and as if symptom, he reported he's suffering from headache as if someone was stabbing a scalpel underneath the scalp from below. So I went to my favorite as if book, Roberts, and I found the rubric loosened from back of her head, the scalp were loosened from the back of head. Together with nocturnal perspiration in the whole body, I prescribed him calcium carbonicum. Calcium carbonicum was also the only remedy listed in this as if symptom of Roberts. Next time, he reported that the headache has almost disappeared, and then he had the next symptom, which was a little bit unusual to me. He reported that he has a sensation in the feet as if the feet were inflated, like, you know, this Michelin, this is tire from the tire company, which is blown up, and suddenly the air fades. And this comes up to 50 times during the day and night. It's very, very short, only a few seconds, but it's very painful. So I looked to Roberts again, and the symptom feet were bloated, as well as in the complete repertory, the sensation of swelling feet. I found Arsenicum Metallicum. So I have not prescribed it before, so I said, okay, I just try it. And next time, he reported the sensation of inflation in the feet disappeared. He received a continued chemotherapy, and this caused as a side effect diarrhea and bloody stool. So I gave him some Hictalgium Picloratum, was the old name, Mercurius Sublimatus Corrosivus. And then the chemotherapy was well tolerated, and the diarrhea disappeared too. Okay, 58-year-old male is suffering from a carcinoma at the root of the tongue. It began with enlarged cervical lymph nodes on both sides. There was a laser resection at the root of the tongue, radical neck dissection on both sides and tracheostomy. Then he received radiochemotherapy until January of 2007. Currently, there was a swelling of the lower jaw and chin. He was unable to open his mouth because of swelling. He was suffering from a dry mouth. The chin was insensible. The voice was indistinct and quiet. And he was also suffering from a stertorous breathing during the night due to the open tracheostomy. During the night, the food remnants and dropy mucus came out from the tracheostomy. The trigger, from his perspective, was the death of his father, which affected him very much, despite the father was 93 years old. He died after 14 days suffering in the hospital, and there was a slow dying following an apoplectic results. And the patient swallowed while talking about this, and he refuses consolation. In his profession at the bank, after 40 years, he has a lot of anger, silent grief. He felt utilized, furious. He doesn't tolerate injustice. He's smoking. Postoperatively, when he was drinking tea, it burned on the base of the tongue and swallowing was difficult. There was a ropey, tough mucus, transpressed as chewing gum. He's very thirsty, and he also suffered because a grandson has died. He's very sensitive. He's anxious about his family. He's hot-tempered, not resentful. He has aversion to company. He likes animals, and he's a hunter, and he has shot his hound because of epileptic fits. But after he has killed his dog, he said to himself, why did I do this? And he could not get rid of it. Why did I do this killing? So I gave him Ignatia, Q1 and Q2, and there was no more burning feeling with the T at the base of the tongue. There was a drawing pain in the teeth with cold and warm food since radiation. I gave him phosphor, but the tip of the tongue still felt as if burned. So taking together all these symptoms, I went to my repertorization, and finally I gave him phosphor QV1 and Q2, and the lymph nodes of the upper jugular group disappeared completely. Sensation of cold was better, the voice was much better, and this drawing of the pain of the teeth with cold and warm food disappeared. And also his weakness disappeared. But he still complained about cramps at the floor of the mouth, and he had a feeling as if there's a belt around the neck. And with MRI and sonography, a fluid cyst was found at the root of the tongue, and the biopsy gave a benign disture. So I gave him barium carbonicum, and next time he said barium carbonicum was like a hammer. 3 days after intake, the burning in urethra and tearing in the nipples disappeared. Two times epistaxis within 4 weeks, the burned feeling of the tongue completely disappeared. The sensation of cold in the region of the palate was much better. The swollen feeling of the palate was better, and the neck cramps were much less. So I think homeopathy might be a helpful adjunct in cancer patients, helping to reduce the side effects of chemotherapy and radiation. Thank you so much for your attention. We'll be right back.